Did I get you? Happy Halloween, everybody. Hopefully you're having a great day today. It's Friday. All right, let's jump into it. So the first thing you got for Big Bear is this recent level of support and resistance. We've seen them bounce between the $6.50 price point and the $7.50 resistance. So you got a support and resistance with the exception of that big break up to $9.45 and an $8 resistance. This is where they're kind of consolidating here from left to right. We do see some downward pressure on the stock. One of the main reasons why is because they have this big giant cloud of darkness working against them, which is the government of the United States is shut down right now. So when the government of the United States is shut down, you have less contracts. Doesn't mean you have no contracts. In fact, we got a contract today from CTM. They were up about 10% at one point, over 20% gain today. So BigBear.AI has had some downward pressure throughout the government shutdown, but they're looking to recover here. They got a support level here, and this is the next target around $7.50, about a 10% gain. Now, with BigBear.AI's current roadmap, it looks like they're focused primarily on where their CEO is connected. Their CEO was previously the Secretary of U.S. Department of Homeland Security and U.S. Customs and Border Protection, the Commissioner. So basically, the guy running the company of BigBear.AI is well connected because he used to work in the government. And so when it comes to things like facial scanners at the airports, okay, the VeriScan technology or the TrueFace technology, or this threat detection for the airports, or this satellite / AI driven ARCUS software, or their partnership with Palantir, it's because they have distribution in a favorable way, I believe, because of their CEO. And so this is an efficient traveler authentication method, facial recognition that's getting deployed at major airports. We've seen them deploy at, let's see, the recent articles. I believe we got Chicago is one. You can see Chicago. They recently were touting that they were at Nashville. That was a new airport that they got into. And then if you look at the further back and you look at their articles that they've come out with, they also had a general list. And the thing is they have a list, but they're at more airports than are on this list. Los Angeles, Denver International Airport, JFK, they're at LAX, Vancouver, all these, Chicago, as we mentioned, Charlotte, Dallas, they're there deploying this VeriScan. Now, this is big because in the era of AI, there are certain jobs that are being replaced, okay? And so in an era where AI is becoming more valuable, it also means that there is a level of responsibility around the data. So as they're collecting thousands or millions of data points on all of these people, and they have the Department of Defense contracts, and they're building out the contracts with the government, the Pentagon, this also is great responsibility of how they're managing that data. And so they're also going commercially. You can see deployed at airports, even partnering with Delta there, SoftPoint, and some others, that is going to allow those terminals and also those companies to operate more efficiently. Now, this is really important that they have integrity in this because they're processing so much data, especially in a world where, you know, AI and facial recognition is not taken lightly. And I know that's a kind of strong narrative to look at, but there's a strong reason to have it as well. One of the main reasons it would be their focus is going to be that World Cup, okay? So 2026 FIFA World Cup, and then the 2028 Olympics are both coming to America next few years. The World Cup is a massive event. Everybody, millions of people are going to be coming in and out of the borders. So when that's happening, you need some technology that streamlines that process. And it seems like they're one of the top companies that are in that conversation. Now, when it comes to some of the institutional holdings, and I'm going to NASDAQ, but rather than going to NASDAQ, I can actually start using our AI tool here. I'm going to search up BigBear AI. Let's get an analysis going. We got Grock, and let's start seeing what the AI is saying about the company. Because when it comes to the market, big, beautiful bill, spending on government contracts and defense is in a good place for them. That market's growing. It's growing very fast. But then you also have the news and the financials. And the news has been the government shutdown. There's a few things to watch, right? So we can actually pull up. We got a projection here over the next 3 months. Grock is bullish. We can pull in some government shutdown data here, which I'd like to get a look at because this is actually really important stuff. The government shutdown is interesting because on one hand, you have people literally turning bullish on the government shutdown because it essentially means that you have the average of the government shutdowns as something that's favorable. When you look at the average return in government shutdowns is 12%. The longest shutdown is 34 days, and I think we're just about to break that record. The government shutdown that just began on October 1st, okay, so we're past that. No, we're not past 34 days, but we're coming up on the record here, is that you have the pressure, while it's green in most markets, the biggest impact is going to be on defense companies because defense relies on government contracts a lot of times. And so short-term impact, you might see the S&P doing good, which it has basically through this S&P 500, a little choppy this last week, but for the most part, it's been green. And then you look at kind of the prediction and the market impacts that defense sector hasn't seen green the last month. If we look at BigBear AI, we've seen consolidation here. We've actually seen a little bit of a spike, but really this stock has not moved since the government shutdown. It's actually flat since the government shutdown. It's got this downward pressure. It's holding below this moving average. And that green line, if it's going to make this move back up into $7.50, it's going to be a bullish move, and it's got to break above here and continue up. Now, it can make that 9% move pretty easily. We've seen this just earlier this month, about a week ago. We were trading BigBear AI in our live sessions, which if you ever want to be there, it's the second link in the description below for Stock Me, and you get a free t-shirt, the one that I'm wearing right now. But also, we were not expecting them to have put up as much of a fight in this consolidation. We thought maybe a little more sharp downward pressure, which we did see some downward pressure, but they made that 15% recovery. They surged 15%. Now they're looking to do something similar, make that move again, about a 15% recovery. So far of that 15%, they've already made a good portion of it, about 5% of it. So about 10%, about 7 to 10% margin for profit here that we've been watching here for BigBear. If they can continue, kind of hold that $7 price range and shoot up into that $7.50 once again. Support levels are right around $6.50. So they're holding above there. Now, when we're looking, you got the government shutdowns. That's one thing. But then you can look at the most affected sectors, that's defense or AI defense. But the other piece to look at here is the top transactors. And this is institutional holdings, okay, and the buyers. So what we've seen has been a lot of buying from some opportunistic institutions. When they came out with earnings, and they got earnings coming up about 10 days from now, when they came out with their last earnings, they sold off aggressively and then surged after that. And that's mainly because they came in with a negative net income, which was writing off one-time payments, a goodwill impairment, and most likely in this next quarter, I wouldn't imagine their negative net income is going to be anywhere close. It's probably going to be similar to what we saw early 2024, and their revenue, I would expect them to increase as they've secured more infrastructure for the Variscan technology in the airports. That's what I would expect. And the balance sheet too, while they had that negative net income and their stock dropped drastically, they also had their assets surge, so they got more cash. Following that move around their earnings, though, this is where it gets interesting. You have much more buyers than sellers. You see Vanguard jumping in, BlackRock basically adding 59% to their position, Vanguard added 69%, Citadel upped their position by 80% after earnings, and then you had Renaissance up their position by 70%. These are not small numbers. They're almost doubling their positions after their earnings. So that was a buying opportunity. Now, if we look at the buys and the sells, and you just take a look at both, take a look at the insiders here, you did see some insider selling. People said, Will, did you see Kevin McAleenan sold back in September? Yes, we saw that. But if you look at how much he sold 3K shares compared to his 1.2 million. I mean, that's literally less than 0.5% of what he sold. So he barely sold any of his position. There weren't any insider sales that were large amounts of their position. For the most part, it was not large amounts of their position. It was like 5% of their position or 2 or 3% of their position based on what I see. And so the general consensus, according to the Grock analysis of all the insider and institutional trading, so the big banks that are following this, according to Grock here, we could check another AI model, but what we're just running here on the machine is that you had 248 buys versus 122 sells. So that's 30% ownership, suggesting growing interest or confidence in the company at a high level. Now, in contrast, you had net selling with 28 buys against 90 sells. It kind of indicates caution or portfolio adjustments among the key personnel. But like we said, there's a lot of sell orders, very small amounts of their total positions. So not very big sell orders, more just kind of getting some cash as, you know, an employee that's probably been working. They want to get some cash for the most part. And that's something that I think we should probably wait. And in when we're feeding this data into the AI, I'm going to actually just talk with my developer here and make sure that we're on the same page as our team is. We all work on this all the time, and I want to make sure that this data is being considered. We should have more weight given to the actual overall percentage of their total holdings that they're selling, because just because there's a bunch of sell orders, but they're not a large percentage of their total holdings, then those sell orders don't have much weight. It's just the quantity of them seems like a lot of weight, but it's not actually indication of bearish momentum. So just got to kind of probably dial that in, if that made any sense. I don't know if that made any sense. Okay, so aside from that, future next 3 months, it's looking bullish from most AI models that we've been projecting with. Another thing to note actually as well, if you guys weren't familiar, that BigBear.AI is actually connected with Palantir as well. They got a partnership there. So are they the next Palantir? I wouldn't say that that's the case, but if you look at some of the technology that they're deploying, it's also not just the Variscan, it's the Panama Canal. They've been building out their Panama Canal technology, that ARCUS that we were talking about. I'm actually quite bullish on that specific technology because it monitors all of the ports of entry and all of the movement of the ships in and out of the different places in the Panama Canal. So that's predictive. Where they're coming from, where they're going, what has been the patterns of them coming in and out. And also the US government wants that data. They're gonna want to have control in the Panama Canal, especially after BlackRock came in, kind of bought out the US government in a way because they went under China's nose because China was starting to get some control in Panama Canal. And now it's back in US hands, but the US probably won't let that happen again. I imagine they're gonna want to look for companies like BigBear that have recently started to move more into the Panama Canal. So if you look at the recent news, aside from their upcoming earnings here, you can also see some recent articles here. For there it is, the Narval Holding Corp, AI-powered cargo security management solution in Panama. So again, I think that that's kind of a sleeper thing. They're working in a very unique part of the market for using their AI technology, and I think it's going to pay off for them. I think that they have some things working in their favor. When it comes to the AI intelligence from up above, So from the satellites, they also have a partnership with Redwire. Redwire is a space company. And I thought that was interesting to note, as I think the CEO of Redwire is on the board of Big Bear, which is probably some good information to just know that they're well connected. Now, next thing in this earnings, we'd like to see them come out with some earnings in this, $40 to $50 million. That's what we were looking for last quarter, $50 million. That'd be really good. It showed really good, strong growth. Net income without the goodwill impairment or any other write-offs, they should hopefully come in with net income much smaller and narrow that down a little bit. That would be a great earnings for them. And again, what you'd look for is also the Q&A in the earnings call, which they didn't do in their last earnings. So they got to do the Q&A, allow investors to get involved, talk with them, see what's going on. That's kind of what's going on. So overall, you're seeing them get some downward pressure. What you don't want to see, if you're a medium-term holder, you probably don't care on the long term. You just add to your position. But if you're a medium-term holder, watching that $6.50 support is key. If they were to sell down to this $5 range somewhere in here, that'd be very conservative. It'd be quite the sell down. So just something to watch as Big Bear has been, again, they've surged. Let's see if we can get a better view. I don't know if this is working. There we go. They've surged and they have this overall uptrend. It would be more bullish to see them bounce, but a conservative sell down would be in that $5, $6 range. It could be possible as they've done that before, but if they're able to hold now with more solid holders, which I believe that's where they're at, they're going to be around the 650, holding above the 650, targeting that 750 next, about a 12% gain from here. Bullish if they can continue the momentum. So we'll be watching them closely, see if any opportunities present themselves on Monday. If you'd like to tune in to our daily live trading, and we're there every day, Monday through Friday, it's inside of StockMate, second link below to tune on in and to get a free t-shirt and lifetime access Monday through Friday with the Quantum Revolution sale that we got going there. Again, it's the second link in the description below. Appreciate you all. Hopefully, I earned your thumbs up. Comment your thoughts down below on Big Bear if you enjoyed, and I'll see you in the next video. Take care.